And I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder. One of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." And I saw, and behold, a white horse. There's a man going round taking names, and he decides who to free and who to blame. Everybody won't be treated all the same. There'll be a golden ladder reaching down when the man comes around. The hairs on your arm will stand up at the terror in each sip and in each sup. Will you partake of that last offered cup or disappear into the potter's ground when the man comes around? Hear the trumpets, hear the pipers.
Welcome to Recovery Reformation Radio. We are the resistance, standing on the truth of God's Word and fighting back against the modern recovery industry that has infiltrated so much of the Christian church. Recovery Reformation is a movement, it's not a program. Breaking through recovery to freedom in Jesus Christ. Do not be conformed to the sinful world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind through God's awesome and powerful Word. You can find us on the web at recoveryreformation.org. The message today is on Philippians 4, 4 through 9. And you guys have heard me refer to this verse multiple times. The title of it is, "Do Not Be Anxious, the Lord is at Hand." I memorized this portion of Scripture without intending to. When we were going through just an extreme struggle in California, and it became clear that we had to move, and we decided to move up here. That 2-3-4 week period was just excruciating with all the financial struggles and the battles that we were in. And it put me under so much pressure that I literally had Philippians 4, 4 through 9 open on my desk, and I was reading it 15 or 20 times a day because it just gave me the strength I needed to get through each day. So I'm going to read through it. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you." Before I dive into the actual Scripture, I want to preface it a little bit and sort of paint a little bit of a picture around it. Matthew Henry, regarding anxiety, said, "There is scarcely any one sin against which our Lord Jesus more largely and earnestly warns his disciples than the sin of disquieting, distracting, distrustful cares about the things of this life." So anxiety is an affliction that we can get burdened under, but what we don't often realize, it's a sin. We're told not to be anxious. I'm not saying that to convict anybody, because we all suffer from anxiety to different levels. It's been a problem that I've struggled with through my whole life. And unless I'm in the Word, and unless I'm in prayer, and unless I'm in fellowship, anxiety is one of those sins that's always creeping to come back. So I have to keep it at bay by doing the things that I'm going to share with you guys today and try to practice what we learn through God's Word to combat anxiety. But how can someone not be anxious amid so much insanity and chaos in a world that is completely out of control? So when I talk about anxiety today, I'm going to be trying to address it on a personal level, the things that afflict us just in our own personal lives. But quite often, the anxiety that people suffer from today comes from the world around us. Because the world is literally out of control. I mean, I don't think we've ever witnessed so much hatred, division, attacks on just such a vast scale. And obviously, a lot of it has to do with social media because information moves so much quicker. Live in a world that is just completely out of control, and I think it's the reason, I know it's the reason why so many people suffer from just crippling anxiety. From a prophecy in the news article, I'll share a couple paragraphs that says, "The shock of rapid change in turn has produced family and social crisis, tension between nations, fear of atomic war and struggle for survival in the world threatened by pollution, starvation, and moral disintegration. The rapidly increasing tempo of change in modern life has given the entire world the sense of impending crisis. Civilization is moving at a rapidly accelerating rate, like a gigantic machine which will ultimately tear itself apart. How long can a world exist with atomic bombs unused? With increasing population and decreasing food supply, with growing moral degeneracy threatening to destroy our civilization. How long can world tensions be kept in check? How long can a world struggling for survival be kept from a bloodbath? The ingenuity of man has devised means of human destruction, which would seem incredible to a previous generation. The world is moving toward a gigantic crisis. Can it be that the prophets of doom are right? Is the world racing toward Armageddon, a divine judgment on a wicked world, the end of human history?" I'm not trying to paint a dark picture, but I'm trying to start with a dark picture. Because we contrast God's word with the truth of the world, and the world is dark. And that's why this has to be exposed like this. If you want your children to thrive and prosper in a biblical sense, now that word prosper can just be taken totally out of context. We've seen that, but if you want your children to thrive and prosper in a true biblical context, we can't hide the truth of this world from them. We must make them aware of the condition of this world, but even more importantly, saturate them with the love of Jesus Christ, with His gospel, with His word. We must raise them up in the ways of God, and this world will have no hold or real power over them. And it's like I've said before, our children, our grandchildren, our friends' children, the children in our church, have got to be edified at a level that we haven't seen in years in the Christian church because of the world that we're moving into. That's just the way it is. We can't slack in raising up our kids in the ways of God. So that means it's not like when I was a kid, the normal thing was if you took your family to church on Sundays, you're dialed in. We're a Christian family. That won't cut it anymore. And that's why I say the sermons on Sunday have to be what the food that your family feeds on throughout the week. You see? Always be in God's word. Proverbs 22, 4 through 6 says, "The reward for humility and fear of the Lord is riches and honor and life." In a biblical context. Again, because of the world we live in, I have to make people understand. And I know all you guys do. When he talks about riches and honor and life, we're talking about in a heavenly sense, building treasure in heaven. "Thorns and snares are in the way of the crooked. Whoever guards his soul will keep far from them. Train up a child in the way he should go, and even when he is old, he will not depart from it." We're commanded to raise our kids in God's word. See? Jennifer and I had coffee the other day, and we were talking about how much somebody should spend in Scripture. Session. When you read about how much we are told to be in God's word and in prayer and in the Christian life, there's nothing left after that. It's just what we do. And that's why he said, when it comes to his word, talk about it when you walk along the way. Talk about it with your children. Write it on your doorpost. Everywhere you go, it's there. put it between your eyes. That's why the Jews, you know, walk around with phylacteries between their eyes, because that's what he thought they meant. No, it should be right here in your head constantly and in your heart. We live in a world of rapidly increasing confusion and chaos. Christians must stand on the rock and take shelter in the arms of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Believers do not have to be weighed down and encumbered by the anxiety and the cares of this world. Our point of view is far beyond the insanity of this world. What I'm trying to do here is paint a picture of the believer versus the non-believer, not versus contrasting the two. See, where an unbeliever has nothing to cling to except the next self-help program, pill, whatever it is, false religion, we literally transcend the darkness of the world if we're in Jesus Christ. We don't have to be weighed down by it. You see? That's why Jesus can say, rejoice always in the Word. But then he says, in the world you'll have tribulation. See, for an unbeliever, that's total insanity. But for us, it makes perfect sense. Because we're not seeing what's in, we're seeing what's in the world, but we're not being drugged down by it. In Matthew 24, 3 through 13, it says, as he, meaning Jesus, sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when will these things be? Because they're trying to figure out, he's talking about he has to die, he has to be sacrificed, he's going to raise up the temple again. When's all this going to happen? So that's what they're asking him. When will these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? And Jesus answered them, see that no one leads you astray. Very important to underline that. See that no one leads you astray. How do we not be led astray? By having discernment. How do we have discernment? By doing what we're doing right here. By being in the Word. By prayer. For many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ, and they will lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed. For this must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. And I don't like to build more than what's in Scripture. The earthquake thing is very interesting right now. I mean, I grew up in Southern California, so you're always paying attention to earthquakes. I have never seen it at the level. They just had an 8-magnitude earthquake in New Guinea yesterday. There's a tsunami warning. I mean, an 8-point earthquake is huge. The Northridge earthquake in like 93 was, I think, 7.1 or something. It was horrific. You see, 8-point earthquake is huge. But all these are the beginning, all these are but the beginning of birth pains. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another. He's talking about the church. You see? Many will fall away and hate one another. And many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because of lawlessness, and because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. So we've got a real issue here with an eschatological issue. If you believe that we're going to be raptured and then there's 7 years of tribulation, why does he say, then they will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death? And he's talking to his church. And this isn't a sermon on eschatology, but we have to be very careful about what we truly believe. Because I've seen the damage of that teaching quite often growing up, where people would say, I'm just so glad Jesus is going to take us away before it gets bad. No, it says they'll deliver us up to tribulation. I'm not trying to scare everybody. John says in the book of Revelation, right in the beginning, I, John, your partner in tribulation, meaning it's already started. So just think about those things. Now let's take that little part that's underlined right before in verse 12. The love of many will grow cold. It's not underlined because I did it right before I came. I'm sorry, Terry. His patience with me, that'll be a test, because I'm literally changing things like until I walk out the door, and he's just like probably scrambling. So the love of many will grow cold. What does that mean? And I think I've got a perfect picture of it. Just, I'll ask this question. The state of New York has right around 20 million people. Now, Now, if I took those 20 million people and I had a bunch of people under my command and I ordered every one of them to be slaughtered. And then we repopulated the state again and we slaughtered that 20 million. And then we let it be populated again and we slaughtered that 20 million. Would that be a bad thing? Today's the anniversary of Roe versus Wade. And since Roe versus Wade was passed, that's how many have been slaughtered. 60 million. That's a picture of the love of many who grow cold. See, our world has become so numb and so toxic that violence doesn't even faze us. We watch slaughter on TV and movies like it's nothing. You see? I mean, we see things on the internet. You just go through Facebook and some of the horrific crimes that are posted and the things that are seen 20 years ago would have just absolutely shocked us out of our socks. You see? That's what the world does to us. Even as believers, we have to pray that these things would break our hearts more than they do. Because to the world, they don't care. They march to increase the numbers. That's what they did yesterday, all over the world. You see? And I'm convinced that that's what it says when the love of many will grow cold. That's why it says because of lawlessness. That's lawlessness. Wholesome murder. The reason I'm sharing this with you guys is because this is where so much of the anxiety comes from in the world. And I don't even think people realize it. You know, we say heart disease is on the rise, strokes are on the rise, all this stuff's on the rise. It's because of the foods and it's because of our lifestyle, but I think a lot of it is because this steady increasing of just tension and anxiety in the world is just chewing people up. You see? Because it's just gotten worse. So let's look at the context of today's scripture. Why Paul wrote what he wrote in Philippians 4, 4 through 9. So Paul originally was led by a vision to go to Philippi. In the book of Acts, you can go to Acts 16. And it'll talk about how the Holy Spirit, God worked things to move him to Philippi. He even used Satan. Satan stopped him in his tracks from going to one place. Then he got a vision of a Macedonian saying, basically, come and help us. And he ends up in Philippi. He plants a church there. And then he went there at least two more times in his later travels. The book of Philippians, it's a book of rejoicing, and it's a book of thanksgiving for the blessings that God has poured out on the Philippian church. And you can read the book. It's only four chapters, so you can read it in 20 minutes. It's a fast read. Well, it can be a fast read. It's very deep, so you could spend 6 months on it, which is how we should read Scripture. I just want to give you a picture of where Paul's coming from when he's addressing this issue of anxiety in the Philippian church. Philippians 1, 1 through 6, in his introduction, he says, Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi, with the overseers and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making my prayer with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. He loved his church. This was his brethren, his brothers and sisters in the Lord. But even though the book is a book of rejoicing and praise, he still has concerns that he's addressing with the church. Philippians 1, 29 through 30, he says, for it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake, engaged in the same conflict that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. So they're beginning to suffer persecution. And he's letting them know that he's aware of it, and it's just a part of the Christian walk. And then in chapter 3, verses 2, and then verses 17 and 18, he warns them. He says, look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. Brothers, join in imitating me, and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. For many, of whom I have often told you and now tell you even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. So he's telling them there are false teachers, and those false teachers are right in your midst. Be careful, be discerning. And then in chapter 1, 27 through 28, chapter 2, 2 through 4, and chapter 4, 2 through 3, he gives a picture of the conflicts that are happening in the church that he wants to address. He says, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind striving side by side for the faith of the gospel, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation, and that from God. That shows us right there, we actually can give thanks for apostates. We can thank the Lord that there's false teachings in the church, that heresy exists, because it shows us more clearly what's right and wrong. You see? He shows us, he says, it's a sign to live, to you, of their destruction, but of your salvation. You see? God works all things together for the good. 2, 2 through 4, complete my joy by being of the same mind. Notice how one spirit, one mind, one faith. He hits this point all through this book. Having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. That unity of spirit. That's why it's so important for a church to have a statement of faith, like I preached on a few months ago. We all have to believe the same thing. You see? And then in chapter 4, 2 through 3, I entreat Euodia and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. So these two, he has heard, are in conflict. And he's telling them, you guys agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. He doesn't want conflicts in the church. So the picture we see there is he's telling them, get rid of your pride. Sometimes we have to admit, yeah, I was wrong about that. That's just part of the Christian walk. One of the most beautiful things is when you see a Christian leader go, you know what? Yeah, I was wrong about that. We have to sort of turn a corner there. But for any Christian to have the humility to say, what I believe wasn't right. You see? There's a lot of false teachers that I know the truth, but they don't want to sacrifice their ministry. So this is the hold on to the apostasy. Where he says in Philippians 4:1, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. That is an antidote, one of the antidotes to anxiety. If we're going to stand firm thus in the Lord, we're going to have an eternal perspective in Jesus Christ. Like I said, our sights are going to be above what this world is. We'll be truly engaged in our Christian walk. We'll be abiding in Christ and in his word. We'll be of one mind, one faith, one gospel, and fellowship. And again, that is so important. Not trusting in ourselves, but instead standing fast in the strength of the Lord by his grace. So now I'll move into the text. I'm going to break it down piece by piece. So he says in Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. All of our joy as Christians flows from God through Jesus Christ. Rejoice in the Lord always. That means regardless of situations, circumstances, conditions, whatever is going on, if we're truly in Jesus Christ and we're not being conformed to the pattern of this world and we're holding the things of this world loosely, that's a beautiful term that the Puritans used to use. Hold this world loosely. Weigh on us so much. So even when things are wrong, we can still rejoice in the Lord because we're looking at the big picture instead of this temporary picture. And then in verse 5, he says, let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Now, reasonableness, if you look at it in the original Greek, basically means unselfishness, considerateness, forbearing spirit, gentle, patient, mild. We don't make rash decisions. We don't engage in arguments uselessly. And the way that we're reasonable is we're always striving to make the proclamation of the gospel and the saving of souls our number one priority. But what have I shared before? In Christ, we strive to stand up for His rights, and that means if we have to, we sacrifice our own. So even if this unbelieved sinner is railing on us, but we realize if we just take that, and then where he says, the Lord is at hand. Quite a few commentators tend to think that that means his time to return is soon. It could be that. I think it means he's at hand in the context of what Paul is writing here. What that's telling us is the Holy Spirit is here. The Spirit of Christ is here, right here with us. And we can get too caught up in thinking of him as something far off or conceptual. But if we have a personal walk with Christ, He's with us right here, right now. And that's why we don't have to be anxious. And He tells us that's the case because in John 14, 26 and 27, He says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. He's saying, when I ascend, the Holy Spirit, which is still Him. See, this is where we get into the Trinity. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is what comforts us now and keeps us from sliding into the anxiety that we're addressing. So we need to take great comfort in that. We don't have to look at our God as something, again, that's abstract. He's real. He's alive. Jesus, as a human, is interceding for us on the throne. You see, when He ascended, it wasn't like His spirit went up. No, His physical body ascended. You see? And the Holy Spirit came to stay with us until Christ's physical return. But He says, let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. But think about this. If we're distracted with anxious worry, we're not giving attention to what is at hand. See? If the Lord's at hand, that means He's where? In time. For us. In this moment. Satan knows that. And one of Satan's greatest tools is to get human beings to exist everywhere in time except where they're at. I did all this stuff in my past. I'm riddled with guilt, remorse. I can never change it. I don't deserve to go to the cross. But like I always run into with addicts, you know, I got to get myself cleaned up and then I'll deal with the Jesus thing. Seriously. That's taking us in the past. And then we can stress about the future. I got all this big stuff coming up, you know. And I'm just obsessed about the future. I could do that right now, you know. We got some big changes coming up. We're going to be moving and stuff. And my mentality, I can totally live like, oh man, if this doesn't happen right, if this doesn't happen right, I can't do that. I have to be in the moment. Because if I'm up there worrying about what's going to happen, I'm not with Christ. If I'm back there worrying about all the crap I did, I'm not with Christ. He's at hand. He's not there. He was there, and He's going to be there, but right now He's here, where I'm at. You see? So we have to be in the moment, or we will be anxious. It's just the way it is. And then in 4:6, He gives us the command, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. It comes right down to it. Anxiety and worrisome distraction are contrary to our faith. They are sin. Our walk with Christ. They weaken our faith. Instead of our belief being deep, it's shallow. because that's what anxiety does. 1 Corinthians 14:33 says, "For God is not a God of confusion, but of peace." So if we're confused, we can't find our way out of something. We have a God that's a God of peace. We don't have to unravel stuff. He'll do it for us. And it's like I've said over and over, I've been through tremendous trials in my life, and I have sat and worried and stressed trying to figure out ways out, planning, manipulating, you know, trying to figure out this way out. And He always comes right out of left field with something I never expected. It makes me look like just a complete idiot. Every time, yeah, He does. That's a blessing. So now, when I look and I'm going into something that I'm not sure how it's going to work out, it could be bad, it could be good, I got to look back and go, even when bad things happened, I still woke up the next morning, I'm still breathing, my heart's beating. You see? Didn't kill me. But more often than not, He solved the problem in ways I couldn't think of. Because that's where He's glorified. Only those in Christ have the light of truth and know what the outcome of the whole thing's going to be. You see? So if this apocalyptic picture that I painted at the beginning does begin to come about, and we start going to the book of Daniel, the book of Revelation, we're like, whoa, this is it. Everybody else is climbing under rocks, and we're like, praise the Lord, look at what we get to see. You know? It's like I've told people before, think about this. You read about the book of Acts and you think, this is the first generation of Christians that got to share the gospel after Christ ascended. What if we're the last? What if that is that rapture and then there's a period after that? Like I said, it doesn't matter what you believe, because you're all, it's a non-essential teaching, but you can say there's a rapture, 7 years of tribulation, mid-trib, 3.5 years of tribulation, post-trib, we go to be with the Lord. But what if you share the gospel with somebody? They don't accept Christ. He takes you home, and they remember that after that. See what I'm saying? How cool would that be? Somebody shows up in the kingdom and goes, remember when you talked to me? That's why I'm here. You see? Because we're going to get to the kingdom, and I know for a fact we're going to look around and go, I can't believe He's here. How come He's not here? You see what I mean? It's going to be that kind of thing. Exactly. Yeah, you just don't know. But when it comes to anxiety, we have to understand as believers there is a proper, diligent concern that we have to have. It doesn't mean we just float through life. We take no concern for anything. God's going to take care of it. I can just be a slob. It doesn't matter. No, there is a healthy concern that we have as believers. Honest concerns for the right reasons from the right condition of mind and heart is not what Jesus commands us against. So consider Paul, if you read 2 Corinthians 11, 24-28, and I've shared this with you guys, I think a year or two ago in another sermon on anxiety. Paul writes, 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews the 40 lashes less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. So if you just take that part of his life, in today's world, you'd be in therapy, completely numbed out. I mean, that would completely destroy a person. Anybody. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I was adrift at sea. On frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, and toil and hardship. Through many a sleepless night in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure. And then he says, and apart from all the other things, there is the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. So he's showing us there is an anxiety that's valid for the church. The people I'm talking about that we write on those pieces of paper. That's the right kind of anxiety. And he says, but in everything, that means we leave nothing out. Bring everything to the Lord and serve the Lord with everything and all of who we are. Deuteronomy 36:5 says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. I use this one all the time with these guys that claim that are Christians, but they want to be part of AA. Well, then how do you reconcile? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and all your might. Because at every meeting it says, those who cannot recover are those who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. Usually those who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. So how do you give yourselves to a program but adhere to Deuteronomy 6:5? You can't. You see? 1 Peter 5:6-7, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. We need to know who God is. Because quite often we can look at God as this king who could just destroy us in an instant. He can if he wants. But all through scripture you'll read about he cares for you. He saved me because he delighted in me. You see, we're his children. Very important that we know who God is. There's so much joy in that. And usually those believers who struggle and bear little fruit in their lives, who are drawn away in anxiety and the cares of this world, do not comprehend who God truly is. That's one of the biggest ripoffs. If you're a Christian and you don't know who God is, make that your passion, your obsession. That's why we read the Bible. Somebody says, they're an unbeliever, why do you read the Bible so much? Because I want to know who God is. That's why we read it. That's simple. Ephesians 3:16-21 says, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. This is why Paul was whipped and pummeled and stoned and ridiculed, and he just kept coming back because he knew who God was. He knew this. Because he wrote this in Ephesians 2. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, that's where he comes right out of left field and does things in a way we couldn't imagine. According to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations forever and ever. Amen. We have to strive to know who God is. So how do we comprehend who God truly is? It's like I said, that's what we're doing right now. That's why we go to church. That's why we're in fellowship. That's why we read the Bible and we pray. When we're seeking Christ and we're following him, he is sanctifying us by showing us more of who he is, and we're conforming his image in the process. And then he says, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. There's passion and there's desire in prayer. And there's joy because we're thankful. Prayer is not for the lazy. And sometimes we have to pray that we will be able to pray with zeal and fervency of spirit. Sometimes we have to pray for months just to be able to pray better. You see? And that's okay. That's why we examine ourselves. Romans 12:11 says, do not be slothful in zeal, be fervent in spirit, serve the Lord. We should just be absolutely on fire for Jesus. Christians should have a passion to wear themselves out. You read about the great people down through biblical history. They worked themselves to death. Charles Spurgeon pretty much died of exhaustion. John Calvin was so screwed up physically that his friends just begged him to stop preaching so much. People talk about retirement. I'm like, show me that in the Bible. You know? Christians don't retire. We just keep preaching. Keep winning souls. You know? It's like I said, I don't want God to come back and I'm sitting on the bench. I hope he takes me back before it gets bad. No, you want him taking you off the battlefield. It's a good job. You see? Because you're so passionate. And if we do that, he promises us in verse 7, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is why we get anxious, because this is beyond our understanding. We have to have faith. The situation I'm going into, it's too dark, it's too much. It's freaking me out because I can't see any way out. Praise the Lord, because he's going to do it in a way we can't understand in the first place. He blesses us with peace beyond our understanding. That's why Jesus made it happen that they went out in the ship and the storm got so out of control that those guys were all losing their minds and like, why are you asleep? Wake up! He did that for us so that he could go out there and say, calm, settle down, and the wind stopped and the waves stopped. He did that with them for us. He's saying, this is a picture of life, and this is how I control it. So when it's wavy and it's windy and it's crazy, just look to me and I'll just get up out of the bow and I'll go mellow it out. That's what he's telling us here. The peace of God, it's a soul at rest in the Lord. It's assured of salvation through Jesus Christ, content with our earthly circumstances and with an eternal focus on Jesus Christ. Circumstances don't matter so much when you're looking at him. When we are burdened, anxious, weighed down with worry, prayer is what calms and brings peace to our spirit. Lift up your burdens and desires to God in prayer. He tells us in 1 Peter 5, 6 through 7, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Abide in God's word and he will inspire you to pray. This is a great lesson. Quite often, the best way to pray is to go to his word, because things will jump. George Mueller would never pray until he'd read the word, because he said that's how God showed him what to pray about. Proverbs 12, abide in God's word and he will inspire you to pray. Proverbs 12:25 says, anxiety in a man's heart weighs him down, but a good word makes him glad. Now that can be looked at as a good word in scripture, or a brother and sister in Christ sharing God's word with us when we're in turmoil. A good word makes him glad. Psalm 94, 18 and 19. When I thought my foot slips, your steadfast love, O Lord, held me up. When the cares of my heart are many, your consolations cheer my soul. Where are we going to find his consolations? In his word. See? That's why our Bibles should be precious to us. He closes verses 8 and 9. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. He's not being arrogant in verse 9. He's saying, this is what I do. Practice these things, and the peace of God that I'll have will be with you. But he's closing with this because he's saying, this is what you look at, not down here, up here. And when he says, whatever is true, consider Ephesians 4, 24 through 25, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness, and therefore having put away all falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Whatever is honorable, in the Greek that means worthy of respect, God. Whatever is just, in Titus 1, 7 through 8, when Paul's telling us how to look at leaders in the church. For an overseer, as God's steward, must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain, but hospitable, a lover of good, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. That's a guideline for leadership in the church, but it applies to everybody in the church. You see? 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus are not just for Christian leaders. Everybody in the church should strive for that. I whatever is pure, 1 Timothy 5:22, do not be hasty in the laying on of hands, nor take part in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure. Lovely and commendable are terms only used in the New Testament. We see them in Jesus Christ. So think of everything Paul's taught, trying to get across to this church in Philippians. And all that they're dealing with. People arguing in the church, false teachers, all these problems. And Paul, it's one of his most beautiful letters. It's just full of rejoicing and just stick together, you guys. Be of one mind, be of one spirit, be pure. And I painted the picture of what it was in the beginning, but now let's look at the closing context. Paul wrote this epistle to the Philippians in which he urges them to rejoice and warns them about anxiety while he's sitting in a Roman prison for preaching the gospel. You see? He wasn't like in a Roman villa overlooking a nice vineyard with a river rolling by. You see? He didn't have like all his commentaries and all the stuff. There's probably rats running across his feet. And he's trying to write. Who knows? He's in prison as he writes this about anxiety. You see? Paul didn't whine and complain about his circumstances, but instead used his circumstances to serve the Lord and bring glory to God, because he had transcended them. In chapter 1, 12 through 14, he says, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. He knows they're worried about him. All his churches are getting word that Paul's locked up. He's in prison. That means you're going to die. Caesar's going to feed you the lions, cut your head off, whatever. So that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. That's why he's rejoicing. I mean, I'm in prison, and look at what's happening. The imperial guard knows why I'm here. All the brothers are being empowered by it. He couldn't have thought that up. God's coming right out of left field again. You see? This isn't usually something I would use, but I think it's a good analogy. You know, there's that saying, when life gives you lemons, make lemonade. Life gives you lemon. Don't make lemonades. Use the lemons for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Whatever those lemons are, fine. How can I use these to share the gospel? You see? That's how we have to look at things. Because he tells us in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. We watched this movie the other night, and it was just the coolest picture of a Christian in battle. Literally and figuratively. It was Hacksaw Ridge. I don't know if you guys have seen it. And in this movie, this guy's a Christian. He doesn't want to bear arms. And this guy takes a lot of flack from the government for not wanting to bear arms. I mean, they want this guy to kill. There's one scene in this where they are on this ridge and this battle is horrific in World War II. They're outnumbered. The Japanese are absolutely, they've been slaughtering them for weeks. I mean, these guys going to fight the Japanese are literally just stepping over bodies and guts and limbs and everything else to go fight the Japanese. And it gets so bad that their only hope is to call in an artillery strike and hope that they can get off the ridge in time. That's how outnumbered they are. So they call in this artillery strike from offshore, and this ridge just lights up, trying to get rid of the Japanese. And this one guy, he doesn't want to leave. He's the guy that won't kill. He doesn't have a gun. He's a medic. And he knows that there's a lot of Americans that are still on top of the ridge, that are wounded, that aren't alive. And when the Japanese come back through, they're just going to slaughter them. So everybody else just goes off the ridge. Stays up there. And he just prays. He says, Lord, just one. And he goes out and he finds one guy and he drags him, ties a rope around him and lowers him down the ridge. And he gets back up and he goes, Lord, just one more. And he crawls back on the back. There's Japanese killing people. He's hiding. And he finds another guy. His legs are blown off and he puts tourniquets on him and drags him to the edge, ties a rope around him, lowers him down for help. And he turns over and goes, Lord, just one more. His hands are bloody from the ropes. He did this 75 times. It's a true story. And as I was watching that, I thought, that's Christianity. We're exhausted. The battle is so seemingly lost. And there's bodies everywhere. And it's black, and it's dirty, and it's filthy, and it's bloody. And we see a soul brought into the kingdom. I know, I wrecked it for you guys. It's a great movie. But I don't know, at the end I thought that is the Christian attitude right there. That's what Paul had, Philip had. Just one more, you see? Just another opportunity to preach, share the gospel, do something for him, you see? That could be our prayer each morning. Close with Psalm 37, 3 through 6. Trust in the Lord and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. And he shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. I underline, trust in the Lord and do good. Delight thyself also in the Lord. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in the Lord. Any power we have is from him. You see, all we do is look to him. Our website again is recoveryreformation.org. You can find us on Facebook for Recovery Reformation or Recovery Reformation Radio, which is a group there. And you can email me at chad@recoveryreformation.org. Until next time, God bless you. I'll talk to you then. Bye-bye. With all